Hello everyone, welcome back to osteology classes. Today we will learn about skeleton of hand. Skeleton of hand made of carpal bones. These are carpal bones which makes the proximal part of skeleton of hand. Distal to the carpal bones there are 5 metacarpal bones. So these are all metacarpal bones. Distal to the metacarpal bones, the bones which are present in the fingers are known as phalanges. So all these are phalanges which are present in each finger. So first we shall discuss about the carpal bones. Carpus means wrist. It consists of 8 carpal bones which are arranged in 2 rows, proximal row and distal row. Each row consists of 4 bones. First, we shall list out the proximal row. From lateral to medial side, the first bone, which is a boat-shaped bone, is called as scaphoid. Next to the scaphoid is lunate. Lunate means it is half-moon-like. So, it is called as lunate. Next to the lunate is triquetral. And the bone which is present over the triquetral is pisiform. Pisiform is a sesamoid bone which is present within the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. Now let us enlist the distal row bones. So the distal row from lateral to medial side, the first one is trapezium. Next to the trapezium is trapezoid. The small trapezoid shaped bone is trapezoid. Next to trapezoid is capitate. Little larger bone is capitate. And the last one is the hamate. So the mnemonic to remember the carpal bones is: she looks too pretty, try to catch her. She S for scaphoid, looks L for lunate, too pretty, 2 is for triquetral, P is for pisiform, and try to catch her. Again T, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, C for capitate, and her H for hamate. So this is a mnemonic to remember the carpal bones. Ossification of the carpal bones, all these bones are cartilaginous at birth. Each carpal bone ossifies by one center and all the centers appear after birth. So there are no primary centers for carpal bones. Capitate is the first bone to ossify and the pisiform is the last bone to ossify among the carpal bones. Let us discuss about the clinical aspect of carpal bones. Starting with the scaphoid fracture, that is the boat shaped bone which is present here. This is the scaphoid bone. The scaphoid is the most common bone which undergoes fracture and usually occurs due to the fall on outstretched hand. Fracture occurs at the narrow waist of the scaphoid. So this part of the scaphoid is often prone for fracture. Clinically, scaphoid fracture presents the tenderness in the anatomical snuff box. When you abduct your thumb, the depression which you find in front of the wrist on the dorsal side is the anatomical snuff box. Blood vessels mostly enter the scaphoid through both its ends, that is from its distal end and the proximal end. So here is the distal end and this is the proximal end. So blood vessels enter from both the ends, usually in all the scaphoid bones. In 10 to 15% of the cases, all the blood vessels may supply the proximal segment, entering it through distal pole. Means all the blood vessels will traverse from the distal pole, enter through the distal pole to supply the proximal segment. So in such cases, if there is a fracture of the scaphoid at its waist, what happens? The proximal part doesn't get its blood supply. So it is deprived of blood supply and may undergo avascular necrosis, which is clinically very important. related to scaphoid. So next, we shall talk about metacarpal bones. The metacarpus consists of 5 metacarpal bones. They are conventionally numbered 1 to 5 from lateral to medial. So the lateral most is below the thumb. So this is the first metacarpal, second, third, fourth and fifth metacarpal bone. Fifth metacarpal is present below the little finger. So each metacarpal is a small long bone which consists of 3 parts, head, shaft and base. So the upper end is the head, the middle is the shaft and the proximal part is the base. So these are the 3 parts of metacarpal bones. Head is the distal end and it is rounded. The shaft extends between the head and the base and it is concave on the palmar aspect and convex on the dorsal aspect. And dorsal surface of the shaft presents a triangular area in its distal part. The base is the proximal end and it is expanded. So that is about the metacarpal bones. So let's see some peculiarities of the first metacarpal bone. The first metacarpal bone, it is the shortest and stoutest. So it is a thicker one which is present below the thumb and it is rotated medially through 90 degrees so that the dorsal surface faces laterally. So here this is the dorsal surface which faces laterally and its base possesses concavo-convex saddle-shaped articular surface. So you can see here it is not like other metacarpal, it is concavo-convex. So it makes the saddle joint. So it is a saddle variety of synovial joint and it articulates with the trapezium to form a saddle joint. So because of the saddle joint, it has wide range of motion when compared to other metacarpal bones. The head is less convex and it is broader than the other metacarpal. It is less convex and the sesamoid bone glide on the radial and ulnar corners of the head. So on each side you can see the sesamoid bones which glide on the radial and ulnar side of the ulnar corners of the head and produces impressions of gliding, and its base does not articulate with any other metacarpal. It has epiphyses at its proximal end unlike other metacarpals which have epiphyses only on the distal end. So these are some of the peculiarities of the first metacarpal bone. Let's see about the ossification of these metacarpals. Each metacarpal ossifies by 2 centers, one primary center which appears for the shaft. So for the shaft it appears, that is before birth, so it is the primary center, and one secondary center for the head. Except the first metacarpal, the secondary center appears in its base. Only for the first metacarpal, the secondary center appears for the base. Let us talk about some clinical correlations of these carpal bones. So the first condition is the Bennett's fracture. So Bennett's fracture occurs with an oblique fracture of the base of first metacarpal. It is the intra-articular and may be associated with the subluxation or dislocation of metacarpals. So it is near the base of the first metacarpal is the Bennett's fracture. So the next condition is the Boxer's fracture. It is the fracture of the neck of the metacarpal and most commonly involves the neck of the fifth metacarpal. So it happens here at the neck of the fifth metacarpal is the Boxer's fracture. So next about the phalanges, there are 14 phalanges in each hand, 2 for the thumb. So there are 2 phalanges in the thumb, 1, 2 I'm writing, and 3 phalanges in each finger. So totally there are 14 phalanges in each hand and each phalange is a short long bone and has got 3 parts. Base, that is the proximal end, so this is the base. Head, which is the distal end. This is the head and the shaft, which is extending between these two ends. Ossification. Each phalanx ossifies by two centers, one primary center for the shaft and the other secondary center for the base. So primary center appears for the shaft and secondary center appears for the base. Clinical correlations. An undisplaced fracture of phalanx can be treated satisfactorily by strapping the fractured finger with the neighboring finger. So this completes the osteology of skeleton of hand.